Defiance Audio.
Unity Palace, Imperial City, Luthien. Pesht Military District, Draconis Combine, 3 February, 3004. Subhash Indrahar seemed a solidification of the night as he stepped between his minions and into the bedchamber. His black internal security force duty uniform was immaculate, from the high collar to the soft split-toed boots. Unlike the men who preceded him, he had made no sound while crossing the nightingale flooring of the porch between the room and the private gardens. The assistant director of the internal security force swept the room with his eyes, swiftly filing away a mental picture for later reference. His own ISF men took up strategic positions, discreetly covering all exits. None of the five showed any reaction to the blood-spattered corpse sprawled on the sleeping mats at the center of the chamber. Four of the other five men in the room were Atomo, the vaunted bodyguards of the coordinator. They shifted nervously, showing the proper amount of fear and respect at Assistant Director Subhash's entrance. The fifth man was Takashi Kurita, his longtime friend. Takashi stood still, his back to Subhash. The younger man was looking down at the body lying at his feet, the corpse of Hohiro Kurita, Takashi's father and coordinator of the Draconis Combine. With the murder of Hohiro by a Razohag assassin, Takashi succeeded him as the head of House Kurita and ruler of the star-spanning Draconis Combine. Silently, Takashi knelt by the body, heedless of the pool of congealing blood that began to soak sluggishly into the knees of his tan military fatigues. He reached out his right hand to lay gentle fingers on the cheek of the face ravaged by the sword stroke that had split Hohiro's skull. Abruptly, Takashi seemed aware of Subhash's presence. Coming toward them was Takashi's wife, Jasmine. She wore a hastily wrapped evening kimono, and her long black hair was still tangled from sleep.
"Husband," she cried, "I awoke to find you gone and heard the guards running. I feared something had happened."
"Something has happened," Takashi stated in a quiet voice. "Hohiro is dead."
Subhash watched Jasmine's face register grief at the passing of her husband's father. A slight movement in the crowd caught Subhash's attention. Forcing his way between the legs of an ISF man, a small figure burst through the assembled servants and courtiers. Jasmine stooped and held out her arms as her son ran across the garden. She gathered him close.
"Has there been a war?" the boy asked, voice full of excitement. "Have you been killing Fedrat's father?"
Takashi pulled the boy from his wife's arms and into his own.
"My son," Takashi said. "This blood you see on my hand is not that of the enemies of our clan. It is not that of a Fedrat, nor that of House Davion. Nor does it belong to any weak-spirited popinjay of House Steiner, nor of any house who shares the inner sphere with us. This is blood of our clan and our house, the blood of the dragon."
Subhash stepped up in time to see the boy's eyes go wide at the carnage in the room.
"Grandfather?"
asked a young and tentative voice.
"Yes," Takashi answered, leaving no room for pity in that single word. "That was your grandfather. He was also the coordinator of the Draconis Combine. That is your future if you are not strong. I am coordinator now, and you are my heir. We are Clan Kurita. We must have the strength to rule, the strength to avoid such an end. We must always do what is necessary for the survival of our house and of the domain that we rule. It is a trust we must never betray. Not for any man or woman, nor for any personal feelings or weakness of spirit. If we are weak, this is the fate that awaits. Ignominious death. Wakari Masuka?"
The boy said nothing. Wide blue eyes still riveted to the corpse of his grandfather, he swallowed, then nodded. Takashi held his son secure in his arms. In the darkness, the pale oval of the boy's face shone over his father's shoulder. Subhash offered the child a smile of reassurance and reached out with his ki, his essence of heart, mind, and spirit, to calm the child from his own well of tranquility and strength.
"I will guard your future, young Kurita."
The boy managed a half smile, and Subhash sensed his relief.
Defiance Audio presents
BattleTech.
Heir to the Dragon by Robert N. Charrette. Performed by Christopher Graybill.
Streets of Kuroda, Kagoshima, Pesht District, Draconis Combine. 12 years later, 17 May, 3018. Breath came hard through the suit filters and sweat ran into his eyes. Rising nausea forced Theodore Kurita to take a risk. He pulled out the heat vents on his suit, cracked the seal on the faceplate, and slid the visor up over his forehead. The ISF sneak suit he wore was not designed for the sustained exertion of his run across the warehouse district. The infrared signature suppression fabrics and noise-deadening air filters had been overworked, becoming dangerous as they overheated his body and limited his air. Theodore's instructors had often warned him that it was hazardous to try a long-distance run while wearing such a suit. As his breathing steadied, he considered how differently the night had begun. He was not expecting any trouble on the eve of his graduation from Wisdom of the Dragon School. 4 long years of advanced strategy and combat training were over. Now he stood here, less than a kilometer from the academy. His panting had almost stopped, but his breathing was still ragged. Concentrating on his hara, he willed himself to center. Slowly, his breathing became regular. He accepted the fatigue in his limbs and banished it. Calmness suffused him, and in that calmness he found another presence. He snapped his head up, eyes working to pierce the darkness. A figure erupted like a demon from the nether hells. The dark figure ran toward him. Theodore cleared his sword in time to parry a passing cut as the other snaked by, turning in a rustle of black fabric and the glint of polished steel. As he turned to face his opponent, Theodore knew he had been hit because there was blood on his opponent's blade. The sword was so sharp that he had not felt its touch. He felt for the pain as he readied himself. The wound felt small, a tiny cut just above the left hip. He hoped his body was not lying to him, concealing the awful truth of a mortal wound. He had no more time to wonder. The other was moving, and Theodore must defend himself. The next exchange was no passing attack. Each black-clad figure stood its ground, trading attack for counter. Unexpectedly, in the middle of Theodore's attack pattern, the other crumpled to the ground. Theodore's stroke whistled through the air above the falling body, pulling him off balance when it did not meet the expected resistance. Theodore recovered, returning to a cautious guard posture as he looked down at the unmoving figure. He was puzzled. He had not thought that he had pierced the other's guard. There was no time to consider. In the distance, he heard the soft slap of running feet. Turning, he ran down a narrow alley, risking a look back just before he rounded the corner. 3 black-clad figures pounded down the street toward the alley, but of his recent opponent, there was no sign. Knowing that the shadows offered no protection from the light amplification equipment of his pursuers, Theodore ran on. By the time Theodore recognized from the echoes that he had entered a dead end, his pursuers had rounded the corner and entered the alley. Suddenly, from the darkness at the alley's end, stepped another black-clad figure. The hood of this one's sneak suit was pulled down around his neck, and his faceplate swung from a loop on his belt.
Enough!
Theodore squinted his eyes down to a slit in an effort to focus his vision. When he did, he recognized the smiling face of Subhash Indrahar, the man his father had elevated to director of the Internal Security Forces.
Do not think me a traitor, my young friend. As ever, I stand behind you as heir to the throne of the Draconis Combine. These men you have faced are a final exam of sorts, a test of your mettle, Subhash said, sweeping his arm to indicate the men gathered around them. You have passed quite well.
You had me in fear for my life, Theodore said.
Of course. Only at the edge of death does a man truly live. And show whether he is.
We hope you enjoyed this preview.
To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.